Honorable Jesus. Honorable Jesus, something in the past. My dear friends of the world. Before I get into an introduction, I wish to mention the members of the panel. The only one that just sits in the end. I have a special connection to him because he is the only person before whose father I have the privilege of practicing in my hometown, second floor. And all the others, I'm happy to mention to you that they have particularly chosen at different times to be able to do the lunch. My choice was made through my entire life to my 16 years. And most of the present judges and the former judges are personally acquainted, though only today only I could come in person and contact with the recent witnesses of the Lord. The question now to be debated today, should judgments be free for the person's philosophy? Or anyone is going to judge? The answer is no. Then the best example is that in this judgment of the Supreme Court of India, in Ayodhya case, where you cannot distinguish which judgment and which part of the judgment, such a way they have been. So the media people asked me, is there a precedent where the name of the author of the judgment is not mentioned? And he said, there are precedents. Both the Kerala High Court and the Supreme Court. And I was part of one judgment of the Kerala High Court where the name of the judge is not mentioned. Because we both judges together wrote the judgment no doubt. But the Ayodhya bar is very sensitive in realizing which part of the judgment is ordered by me? So on the thing to me, I said, this could have been ordered by your judgment. And he asked him how. He said, we are familiar with the way in which you are writing the judgment. So in Ayodhya case, I am not able to say which part has been added by which judge. But it is very good that such a momentous judgment is not capable of being distinguished whose form has formed, even in the agenda added to the judgment, the identity of the judge is not distinguished. Another media man asked me, suppose there are other dissenting judgments, should we not know that? There is no use, I told them. Because in the Supreme Court, dissenting judgment will be used for only for the future. The majority of the judgment of the bench. The best example I said is just one of the cases where the narrowest majority had the rule, the most momentous juristic part of the constitutional law, which has now become the accepted world law as a very laudable proposition in the development of law. Therefore, my answer to this question immediately without attending the panelist assessment is to say no, temporarily. But when we go into the question, you have to change your answer because very often the process of judging gets crystallized by the personal use of mental matters. If that was not the position, according to me, no, not the ground at all. For example, when the law is the same, facts are the same, how could different conclusions be made? There are lies in the answer also. When different conclusions are made, the juristic position on that has been beautifully narrated by a great judge in this state. Two reasonable persons on the same set of facts can reach diametrically opposite conclusions without forfeiting the credential of being reasonable persons. The authorities of this proposition have proved later that it is so. Not a people and not a people. And Lord Green. There are the best examples of that. According to Lord Green, judges are infinitely various. Some are learned, but some are not. Some are talkative, some are classical, or talk very little. Some are interrupting judges. Some do not. Some work hard. And some are lazy. Some write too long. Some are very brief. This is included in his famous book, Judges and Judicial Powers. Some always agree. And some very often disagree. As a student of law, I was following one particular case. I was a student of the Madras Law College. I mentioned to the Lord that he just is today about that. The incident happened when I was studying law there between 1959 and 1959. The incident happened in Trivandrum, the city of Trivandrum. There is a modern tourist home just opposite to the secretary building. I don't know whether that is still there. Are they now? Modern tourist home is there? Formerly, the MIS used to go there for lunch. Now you have Paisa hotels for lunch. The owner of that hotel is the one Krishna Nair. His wife's name was Sarasudina. One day, she was on a visit. And immediately, Krishna Nair got a complaint, my wife is missing. And the city police registered a crime and made big circus. And somebody informed that the lady who can answer the featured birth of Sarasudina was found in the railway station. So Krishna Nair rushed to that place with the help of the police, but it was a different lady. Like that, it went on for 2 or 3 or 4 days. Then, in the night, somebody pedestrian noted 3 or 4 stray dogs were competing with each other inside a compound on a moonlit day. And it was closely watched, it was the hand of a dead body. Cutting short the story, the dead body was visited and it was later identified to be that of Sarasudina. Again, cutting short all the facts of the case, Krishna Nair was arrested as accused number one, the husband. And his servant, Shivaraj, was arrested later as accused number two. The case law is reported 1960 Kerala Law Times, where the sessions judge acquitted Krishna Nair and convicted Shivaraj on the basis of a judicial confession made by him. And it was the sessions judge who later became a very famous judge of this court, Justice Redefine, water the judgment came, the benefit of doubt to Krishna Maya. The matter reached this court. In the trial court, Krishna Maya was defended by the Advocate General of the Estuary Trial Court, A.D. Bhutkarshavala, who was a very famous criminal lawyer. In this court, Shivarajan was defended by equally famous criminal lawyer here, holding my same name, though I don't, I cannot even have a match anywhere with him. He defended it. The case appeared before two judges who later became the chief justices of this court. One was Justice K. Shankar, and the other was Justice P.T. Narayan. The case was heard for a number of days, and ultimately there was a state appeal against the defendant. That is important. And ultimately, when the judgment was pronounced, the two judges agreed on one point, that is, Shivarajan's submission is confirmed. In the case of Krishnanaya, as the judgment is not complete, it was postponed. 2 weeks after the hearing, the judges said. And on the second day, the judgment was not pronounced on the ground. The judges are referring. They are making an endeavor to make a unanimous judgment, post it for another. It went on to the second day. You are showing the results. The time is over. A little more. I'll come with you. Anyway, on the fourth sitting, the judgment was pronounced. P.T. Ramamaya, Justice P.T. Ramamaya agreed with him. Justice Vedipula, Justice Shankaran disagreed with P.T. Ramamaya and found that Krishnamaya is more guilty than the Shivarajan for the conspiracy and for the abetment, etc., etc., and sentenced him to be hanged. The matter was submitted to a correct judge. Incidentally, that was also heard by the first Chief Justice of Kerala High Court, Justice K.T. Koshi. He heard the prosecution side presented most favorably by the first Advocate General of Kerala, K.V. Sujanarayi, and the opposite side, of course, by the other advocate. After hearing, Justice K.T. Koshi agreed with him. Justice Shankaran and the capital sentence was confirmed. The matter was taken up to the Supreme Court where Shivarajan's conviction was SLP was dismissed and Krishnamaya's matter was heard again and again, and finally the Supreme Court judges agreed with them. The Sessions Court judge that gave benefit of doubt. Why I presented so much of facts? Only to show you. Same set of facts, different judges at different levels coming to different conclusions. Can you not say that their personal philosophy would have been influenced in some way or the other? For that matter, I would mention Justice O. Chennappa Reddy, whom I consider to be one of the most ablest criminal judges ever sat on the Supreme. He said, judges may differ on appreciation of evidence. One he pointed out, the natural reaction of a witness witnessing an incident. Justice Chennappa Reddy mentioned five instances. One, a witness seeing an incident may have run away. Another witness seeing the same incident may remain rooted, transfixed. And the third person, he may jump into the fray and physically try to prevent. And the fourth man may call out others, come, 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 etc. And the fifth man may make an appeal for peace to the warring faction. And Chennappa Reddy put a question, can you say, that because the fifth man had not acted in the manner as the other four persons acted, that all the other four persons are incredible, not acceptable witnesses. Equally important question he asked, what is meant by casual witness? If an incident happens, he said, the inmates of the house are the most natural witnesses if the incident is in a dwelling house. The drunkards are the most natural witnesses if an incident happened in a liquor shop. Prostitutes are the most natural witnesses if the incident happened in a brothel. Colleagues are the most natural witnesses if an incident happened in an office. Similarly, he said, pedestrians are the most natural witnesses if an incident happened on the road. About that, he said, the judges differ. Those judges belong to the English aristocracy, baronage. When they came to India, their approach to mental factors are different. They could not even believe how could, in a moonlit light, somebody could witness an incident, because in England it is not possible. In India it was possible, because even in smallest rangal light, people could see. The eyesight was, optical vision was adjusted in such a manner. He further said that in England, a baron used to visit another castle by giving a prior notice, I am coming there. It is a ritualistic visit. In a society like India where casualness and atavism is very common, there is no such practice of giving any notice. On the way, he feels, on an evening I will have a visit to my friend, that is all. I close down by mentioning one very, very important thing also. E.M. Shankaran Nambudiripa was the first Chief Minister of Kerala State. I would say that the reformation of the Kerala judiciary, or even the Indian judiciary, owes very much to his attack on judiciary at that time. As a Chief Minister, he said that courts are instrumentalities to perpetuate the erstwhile feudal outlook. He was proceeded against for contempt of court for this purpose. He said that courts have a tendency to instinctively lean in favor of a person who is well dressed, pot bellied, wealthy, and his credibility is acceptable to him, in preference to one emaciated, ill-dressed, and belonging to the lower strata of the society. Because he said so, according to me, he only said the fact. Because when I started my practice, the last question put to the witnesses at that time, how much is the revenue you are paying, the tax you are paying, and that decides question. He was convicted notionally, but the statement which he made had the effect of cleansing the judicial system very much. See how judges belonging to, depending on which situation to decide the cases. For all this, what is the guiding factor? There is only one section and a very small word. That word is called a proved, that you can see in section 3 of the Evidence Act. A fact is said to be proved when, after considering the matter before it, the court either believed it to exist or considers its existence so probable that a prudent man ought to act upon the supposition that it exists under the circumstances of each case. Here, who is the prudent man, you know, is the judge. It is an expectation of the legislature that every judge is a prudent man, and he will reach a conclusion counting it is so probable, and it postulates two things. When the judge, being a prudent man, he considers its existence so probable. Here lies the answer to the subject. The judge believes. How and when the judge is supposed to be a prudent man? I am mentioning this particularly when Justice Basant and Justice Prema both took different views on this word prudent, and therefore you are going to be benefited by their contribution also to this debate. This word prudent, how to approach in that matter. I reserve my right to add a little more if needed after hearing the exposition made by the members of the panel. Thank you very much.